All right. Well, welcome to Pop Culture and the Bible, the show that's going to show that there's a little bit of Bible in all of us and all of our pop culture. So with me is with us today is Michael Duncan, author of Shadow Remnant, one of the many books that he has given me that I have yet to get around to reading. But especially, what was the name of the book that you wrote that is literally big print, small book, written like it was written for my sister and me?
It's called For King and Crown.
See, For King and Crown discusses your faith and your conversion.
Yep.
And it's another good book for our customers to buy, given the fact that I have not.
Right. Yeah, you're not helping people say that they want to read it when you're not reading them yourself.
But you're very funny in person. Therefore, you know, I've got lots of books I'm not reading. I'm really bad about reading. In fact, that the fact that I write a book is embarrassing because... Yeah. But I don't read it often.
You do read it, though.
I read it just to catch up where I was in the writing, and then all my time is spent just reading the book, and then I get no new writing done, and then the next time I pick it up, I have to start fresh at the beginning, read back to where I didn't get finished.
Well, and let me tell all the viewers that are watching this right now, my books are worth reading.
Yes, they are. So is mine, but you'll find out later.
All right.
Way later at my rate. Okay. So what we're going to talk about today is what's considered the definitely the first, but the most the Christian episode of Star Trek.
Yeah.
There are a lot of people that think it's the only Christian episode of Star Trek. You have to kind of dig deeper in the other episodes. Mm-hmm. But what was your impression on when the Enterprise went to Roma? No, wait.
Magna
Roma. That's yes, it. Magna Roma.
Yeah, for those that are watching, the episode is called Bread and Circuses. And
yes.
It's about going to a planet where the Roman Empire actually was victorious and had never collapsed, which is quite a telling story. Mm-hmm. And in the midst of the story, they encounter a group of slaves who had...
The sun worshippers.
Yes, they were worshippers of the sun, thinking that they were talking about the sun in the sky. You discover at the very end of the episode that Uhura says, no, it's the Son of God.
What a difference a letter makes.
Absolutely. And so that is perhaps the most Christianized episode.
Well, the thing she also did that was nice was she talked about the fact that the radio hosts were all trying to make fun of it, that deity, and they couldn't, which was a real endorsement for the faith in that regard. I just wanted to add that part.
Yeah, absolutely.
Nichelle Nichols did a really good job with her, you know, a small part for as important as she played at the end.
Well, honestly, I think she played the most important role.
She did, but she didn't get much screen time for it, is all I'm saying.
No, not at all. But it's unlikely that they're going to give anything positive towards Christ a lot of screen time. No. However, it was there. But one of the things that's interesting to me is that throughout pop culture, you watch movies and television shows, and you start discovering, if you know the Bible well enough, you start discovering biblical quotes throughout all of these pop culture shows that have become colloquialisms of our society.
Yeah.
To love one another. These kinds of quotes, you know. That
they had Confucius for that one too, though.
Perhaps, but there's so much of the Bible that is woven into our cultural language that most people don't even understand. Most people don't realize they're quoting the scriptures. I've heard so many people talk about being a good Samaritan. Does anybody know that that's out of the Bible?
Right.
That's out of the Gospels, the story of the good Samaritan. These kinds of things pop up, and then when Star Trek does an entire episode on it, about encountering a group of people who became a follower of this Son of God, then at the very end, I think personally, where Uhura opened up the dialogue, that it became they closed the dialogue quickly. Because of the final line,
the thing that I wish I'd remembered to look up was the writers' names, because Roddenberry is kind of famous for not liking this episode, but it still went through. Mm-hmm. So I don't know really whose pet project it was, whether it was the studio mandating it or a very trusted writer. Mm-hmm. But we'll probably put it on the screen to hide the fact that I'm an idiot, and the name of the writer will probably be there. I don't know why Roddenberry thought the future would be better without religion, because as we've been seeing religion decline in our own country, it hasn't been a good thing. It seems to be moving us more toward chaos than anything.
Yeah, the contrariness to religious living, let alone biblical living, but just religious living, the contrariness in our world today, in our society in America today, is astronomical. The hatred towards that, and right now there is a study that was done by Barna Research that says that by the year 2045, I think they said, if I remember right, that the Christian population of America will be the minority population of America. That right now they say 64% of the population openly declare themselves to be Christians. I look at the way society is going and I say there's no possibility that we have 64% Christianity in America. America is falling off the rails. And yet, you know, people who go to church are identified as a Christian, or people who have a religious background will identify as a Christian. But Christianity is not about merely going to church or having a religious background. Christianity is about having a relationship with Christ.
So you're afraid that we're going to become more of a creed than a religion?
Well, for most so-called Christians, that's already what it is. It's merely platitude. It's merely something that becomes, again, it becomes the language of a culture rather than the conviction of the heart.
So I have a friend who, he thinks he's covered in faith, and you know, maybe he is, but he just said, his response has always been, I said the words when I was younger, so, you know, I'm fine. And it's, there's no walk, as you guys say. I mean, I've troubled my own producer with my own, you know, casualness with the faith, and it's still sad to hear someone just say, I said the words, and I don't, you know, what would be your position on that?
I think that's absolutely ludicrous. Saying the words
alone,
it's as if you've made Christianity a mantra. No. You just you make it some kind of recitation. But the book of James says, you say you have faith, but I'll show you my faith by what I do. Paul warned in the book of Titus, he said, they claim to know God, but by their actions they deny him. Jesus warned us in the Gospel of Matthew, many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, but he says, I will tell them, depart from me, for I never knew you.
Now, the words that he's bringing up are the Roman road, which is a very common thing in our faith as Southern Baptists.
Sure.
I mean, even though we're kind of independent of that. And just saying the words is almost sold to the people they talk to. Or at least they talked to. I can't speak to the current policy.
I will speak to it. I am appalled by it. I'm appalled by our evangelicalism and the approach that we've taken. To use an understanding from Vacation Bible School, they call it the ABCs of Christianity, and they make it into a little ditty. And it's a beautiful, cute little song that the kids sing. Now, I don't mind the song, and I don't mind the kids singing it. I think Vacation Bible School has a wonderful role in the church. But it's three things. ABC, admit to God you're a sinner, believe, and confess Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord. Okay, that's nice. And so they go through a ritual, an ABCs. And I've morphed it into three R's. And so here's my three R's taken out of the statement of the Apostle Paul in the book of Acts. I preach that they should repent, return to God, and prove themselves through their actions. So what I have is repent, return, and respond. Repent away from sin, return to God through Jesus Christ in faith in him, and respond in submissive obedience to the Lord Jesus Christ and his word. That's what the Apostle Paul preached. And I think that's a little bit more to the point of what salvation looks like. But I don't want to make that into a rote, into a, just a mantra.
My point of this is that we have created these mantras to help people understand. Okay, fine, those are nice colloquials, but those are that's not the means of salvation. People don't get saved because they know the right words. People get saved because they have surrendered their life to Christ. And so, you know, when we see these things that from time before they used to try and help people understand, now today they've become nothing but rote recitation. And people think, like your friend said, well, I said all the words, and so I'm good, I'm covered. Well, I would say that that person is in deep denial and in danger of hell. Because he has believed a false narrative concerning salvation. What Gene Roddenberry tried to create in Star Trek, and I like Star Trek, I'm a big Star Trek
fan. So am I. Obvious. These weren't cheap.
What he tried to create with Star Trek is a utopian view of what society could become if all mankind worked together.
No.
The problem he extracted from mankind was the core nature of sin. Now, there are some folks and characters that are still bad. He still has some bad people in there.
Sure.
But most of the bad people are
aliens. Or other races.
Yeah, off in the distance.
Other species, technically.
Yeah. And so mankind is in this utopian view, and they have generally a good, well-balanced society without God at all.
Right.
And so he took and he created this image of what it could be. And so when they add Christ to it, a lot of people will view that as see Christ as just part of this utopian view. That not that Christ is the only hope of salvation, but it's okay to have Christ or whatever other faith that you want to have. And so when you get the Gospels mixed in with society, with pop culture, you water down the gospel for the sake of pop culture. And though I think Uhura made the greatest quote ever in a Star Trek episode, that this is the Son of God.
It seems illogical for a sun worshiper to develop a philosophy of total brotherhood. Sun worship is usually a primitive superstition religion.
I'm afraid you have it all wrong, Mr. Spock, all of you. I've been monitoring some of their old-style radio waves. The Empire spokesman trying to ridicule their religion. But he couldn't. Well, don't you understand? It's not the sun up in the sky. It's the Son of God.
Yet it's in a reality that is a watered-down version of the truth.
I also like the fact that the original deck plans still have a chapel.
They do?
Apparently I hadn't eaten today.
Well, I'm not that big a Star Trek fan.
Well, yeah, I'm pretty far gone, but the next gen, I think they got rid of it. But the original series had a chapel on the ship.
Well, that's good. I just never knew where the bathroom was.
They don't, every stateroom has one, though. They call it like a refreshing area or something like that.
Well, I'm sure it would. So, anyway, but back to that episode.
Yeah.
You come to a planet where you have the Roman Empire ruling all of mankind, humanity.
And
you have this faction group of, you know, those who are worshippers of the sun, as they call themselves.
And that the sun, it was a peaceful religion and all the things that, according to Spock, was not typical of a sun worshipper.
Yeah.
Because sun worshippers with the U were warlike and, you know, things along those lines.
Sure. What you don't hear in this episode is how they got to become worshipers of the sun.
You heard a little bit of, I think, Leonidas. I believe he gave a little bit of his story. But
what they didn't talk about is Jesus Christ coming, being crucified, resurrected.
No, he was a man of war who became a man of peace through,
And so who is the Son of God that they're worshiping? They don't identify him as Jesus Christ, the risen Savior.
Right, because that would have ruined the Uhura line at the end.
Yes.
You know, I mean, someone reveals it. I thought that was a big shoe drop.
It would have been a great thing for them to...
Actually, not a bad mic drop, you know.
Have an opportunity for that moment where she says it's the Son of God.
Right.
That... somehow, maybe earlier in the episode, that one of the characters of the freed slaves or the slaves that had escaped would have said, yes, he was the one who died and rose again.
But even Kirk at the end was like, oh, you know, he sounded like a believer in the sense that they just, even now, they just heard, you know, and they did say that, you know, you had Caesar. And they had Caesar, and they had Jesus as well, you know, so...
Yeah, he said they have Caesar and the Christ is the name.
Was it the Christ? I thought he said Jesus.
No, they said the Christ, because they want to keep it alliterated. Caesar, a C, Christ, a C.
Okay.
So they have Caesar and Christ. And this is the way McCoy put it. This is the watered-down thing that I told you. Nah. McCoy said, a philosophy of dominion or a philosophy of total love and peace.
Philosophy of total love and total brotherhood.
A philosophy.
All right.
Not a,
but he said that when he was dealing with the people on the planet.
No, he said that.
He said that at the tail end?
It's the last scene.
Okay.
On the
bridge.
They're on the bridge.
Right.
Spock and a gang all hanging about. Captain Kirk there near his chair. Uhura's telling them that they're all a bunch of knuckleheads.
This is the problem when you have two people that think they remember the episode well enough to do a show, and neither of us did our research, and I apologize. If either of us turn out to be wrong, you let us know in the comments down below. And if we're both wrong, you just let us have it.
Surprisingly enough, I'll be right. So, but... it's that watered-down idea that Christianity is a philosophy.
Mm.
It's not.
No, it's a way of life.
It is a relationship to the Savior. Christianity is Christ, is Jesus. Mm. Anything outside of that, and you got it wrong.
No.
And people who have...
I have some things wrong.
A philosophy of total love and peace is the Gene Roddenberry utopia. That's what was brought out at the end.
Right.
And it wasn't necessarily Christ, though he was the instigator of this philosophy. It wasn't because he paid for humanity's sins. It wasn't because he died on the cross. It wasn't he took the wrath of God upon himself. It wasn't that all mankind were wicked in desperate need of salvation. None of that. All it was a philosophy. And that's my contention. When we start mixing the Bible with pop culture always...
You're trying to cancel my show before it gets started.
Not at all. I hope not. It's worth watching. And the episode is great. I'm a Star Trek fan. I just don't buy into the idea that they understand the scripture.
Could it have been the time period also, though? Because, oddly enough, I didn't think about the fact, because I was just wearing this Vision shirt yesterday. But... this is in the late 60s, mm-hmm. and there was a comic from the Avengers where the Vision, they're on the edge of a thing, the team is assembled, they don't like their chances, and they said, what can we do? And the Vision says, those of us that can pray. Mm-hmm. And then he thinks to himself that he doubts that the creator of the universe would care what a robot has to think. You know, it was just kind of a really depressing thought from his standpoint, but he still saw the value of prayer.
Sure.
And I thought that, you know, again, that's that time period, though, it was in the late 60s, whereas now you can't get Marvel Comics to acknowledge a single creator.
That's not true.
Well, you mean the one above all, which is the generic thing they give their name of God.
No. And I think it's one of the only Avenger movies I've actually watched.
In the movies, yes, Captain America says the thing that it's like there's only one God, and I'm sure he doesn't dress like that.
Yeah, great line.
Yeah, it is a great line, and it tells me that Josh Whedon went to the source and the source of the Avengers were the 60s, where there was there was a lot of God talk in in the 60s comics, but it went away in the 80s.
Really? Well, I don't read comic books, so I don't know.
I stopped reading them. As I already said, I stopped reading just about everything, so anyway.
Don't stop reading. Keep reading the Bible.
Yes.
The wealth of wisdom that God has given us in His Word, but it's useless without a relationship to Christ. And that if your viewers ever get something from me, they're going to get this, is that pop culture can be fun. I enjoy many aspects of it, but none of it will save you. You can never philosophize your way to a utopian humanity. It's never going to happen, no matter what Roddenberry hopes. And the reality is we will all stand before God.
Well, I don't know if that's the best possible ending for our show, but it seems like the strongest.
Okay.
So, you know, if you liked what we had to say, and if you like what we're doing with this this program in our channel, just, you know, comment below. Press the like button. Yeah, I'm going to say press. I'm sick of these smash the like button people. Yes. You know, just press the like button if you liked what you saw. You can hit the bell notifier, but, you know, we're going to try to be better about putting on shows. So.
And don't forget to subscribe.
Yes. If you haven't subscribed, subscribe. Those of you that have subscribed, thank you for staying with us all this time. And
well, thank you, Dan.
Not a problem. Thanks for coming. All right.